whether you're here or overseas or wherever you're watching this, Merry Christmas. That was not as excited as I need. Merry Christmas. Is it okay now? We can celebrate Christmas now? My wife and I have been celebrating for about a month and a half, so you all are just late to the show, I guess. But we're going to kick it off with some Christmas music. Is that okay? All right, here we go.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs implore. While fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sound. Up, I come alive. Oh,
gone, the future can we? Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. I breathe you in and shout out your praise. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. Oh, your face brighter than the sun. Oh, your grace rewrites every wrong. Wherever I go, I'm never alone. I'm waking up, I come alive. Oh, the past is gone, the future can't wait. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. I believe you in a shout out your praise. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. This is Christ in me. This is Christ in me. I'm living unashamed. Now my heart's forever changed. This is Christ in me. This is Christ in me. My past is in the grave. My sin is washed away. This is Christ in me. This is Christ in me. I'm living unashamed. Now my heart's forever changed. This is Christ in me. This is, let's get our hands back on. Past is gone, the future can't wait. Come on. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. I breathe you in and shout out. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. Oh, the past is gone, the future can't wait. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. I breathe you in and shout out your praise. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. I won't forget, sing with me, the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh,
you're the God who fights.
You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through. By day is the sign that you are with me. The fire by night is the guiding light to my feet.
You found me,
you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. And now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. 'Cause you stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love.
God is what?
You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea. You have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of.
Can we sing that chorus one more time? Oh, praise the Lord. Just our voices. Oh, praise the Lord. Father, we thank you so much for this morning. God, just another chance to worship you. We do not deserve that, but yet you gave us breath in our lungs to sing to you. And God, as that song, Song of Moses, reminds us, we need to look back so we can look forward. God, that all the amazing things that you've done, you are still the same God. You are still the same God that brought Israel out of Egypt. You are the same God that brought them to the Promised Land. You are the same God that brought us Jesus. You're the same God that rose Jesus from the dead and that conquered sin once for all. God, you are the same God that performs miracles. You are still the Creator. And as we look back at all the things we've done, you've done, God, I just ask that you would help us to look forward with confidence and faith and live free. That when you say you are coming back, you will. When you say you will never leave us or forsake us, that is true. When you tell us that it's not good to store up treasures here, we need to take you at your word. Because you are that same God that has the best in mind, because you know the best. You are the best. And yet you allow us to be a part of this amazing story that you're telling. God, we thank you for chances to worship, but we just ask that you would help us to do that every day of our lives, in all seasons, good and bad, that we would wake up every day not worrying and putting faith in fear. But God, I'm waking up every day looking for the opportunities that you've given that are sufficient for that day. Being where you want us to be. Walking as if we are walking toward eternity. And living as if that's a reality. Actually living free. As you have set us free, as we follow you as our Lord and Savior, we have been set free for a purpose, to live in good works that you prepared beforehand. So God, teach us now from your word what that looks like in our day-to-day. Ancient words, ever true. Written for us. And so now as we open that ancient book with timeless truths, God, teach us how to live as you would want us to live, righteous lives. Not for our gain, not for our glory, but for yours alone. Bringing hope to a world that is hopeless. We love you, Father. We pray for this time, that it would not just become head knowledge, but it would become knowledge that flows out of our hearts into our hands. We love you, Father. We lift this time to you. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray this as a church. Amen. You may be seated and the kids can be excused to the back.
Hello everyone, here are the three giving options for the First Baptist Church of Hesperia. You can go to our website at fbch.org and choose Give at the right side of the menu. On the Give page, enter the amount you wish to give and choose if it is a one-time or a recurring give and press Next. You will then be asked to enter and confirm a phone number to continue to the payment page. Another option is by cash or check. Please mail checks to 9280 Maple Avenue, Hesperia, California, 92345. Thank you for your giving faithfulness. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to call the church.
Hi, I'm Jason, and this is my wife Amanda, and we're with Skate Riot, and we're here to read your morning announcements. The Peru Information Meeting is today after the 10:15 a.m. service. Join them in the dining room and hear all about what we do and how you could be a part of our Peru missions. Also, Skate Riot, that's us, we're hosting a Christmas event for our foster families. We do this every year, and we will need your help, and we'd love your help, to come and help a more memorable experience. Please use the sign-up sheets at the Welcome Center. Men, come together and encourage one another in fellowship, all while enjoying a good meal. Men's breakfast is Saturday, December 3rd. Invite someone new and come and enjoy a great meal. Clay Women's Ministry is coming together for their final event of the year, Coffee and Testimony Night. Come by and be encouraged and inspired by vulnerable conversations and witness the evidence of lives transformed by Christ. Food and hot beverages will be available. Join us for our Christmas program, Go Tell It, on Sunday, December 18th at 5 p.m. This will be a multicultural night of worship and encouragement about how the good news is all about and what we should be doing. Go and tell it. Our service times are changing next year, beginning the second Sunday of January. Our service times will be 8:30 a.m. for traditional service, 10:15 a.m. for contemporary, and 12 p.m. for the Spanish service. This will be beginning January 8th. Our midweek classes will also be changing. Please plan accordingly.
Thank you all for joining us this morning. If you're a guest with us, we invite you to fill out our welcome card. Scan the QR code in front of you and fill out one at the Welcome Center. Turn it in at the Welcome Center, where we can meet with you and send you home with a welcome gift for being a guest with us this morning. If you've been with us for some time now and feel ready to take the next step, fill out our serving card. You'll get connected with ministry leaders and learn about serving in the ministries you request information for. No experience necessary. We'll train you. Thanks again for coming. Have a blessed day.
Galatians chapter 5. Sometimes it's just best to move on, right? Galatians chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. And we've been verses 1 through 15 today. Thanks for joining us this morning online as well, wherever you may be. Pray God has blessed you and had a great Thanksgiving holiday. I wore a suit today just to see if it would still fit, and they fit with room to spare, so that's a good thing. And so for that as well. And so remind you of those things coming up as part of the service that are in the coming days here at the church, because as you can see, we're all now moving into from Thanksgiving to Christmas, and so we want to get ready for those types of things as well. So you guys can't do anything to destroy me today, because in the last service, we baptized a 70-year-old and a 91-year-old. That's pretty cool. And so, yes. Galatians chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. Take note, I, Paul, am telling you that if you get yourselves circumcised, Christ will not benefit you at all. Again, I testify to every man who gets himself circumcised that he is obligated to do the entire law. You who are trying to be justified by the law are alienated from Christ. You have fallen from grace. For we eagerly await through the Spirit, by faith, the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision accomplishes anything. What matters is faith working through love. Amen. You were running well. Who prevented you from being persuaded regarding the truth? This persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole batch of dough. I myself am persuaded in the Lord you will not accept any other view. But whoever it is that is confusing you will pay the penalty. Now, brothers and sisters, if I still preach circumcision, why am I still persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been abolished. I wish those who are disturbing you might let themselves be mutilated. Paul is encouraging words here this morning. Amen. For you were called to be free. Brothers and sisters, only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in one statement, love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out or you will be consumed by one another. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time of worship and time in your word. As I pray every week, I pray I would decrease and you increase. Speak to our hearts and to our minds, not just for information, but for transformation. Make us more like Jesus, for your glory and your kingdom. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You know, most people like how-to. If you go to the bookstore, if you go on the Amazon.com and you go to the how-to or ask for the how-to, I mean, there's just an endless parade of books on how-to. YouTube. If you want to know how to do anything, you can go to YouTube. How to fix a toilet. It's right there. How to build a computer. It's right there. How to shine whatever, buff whatever. How to do this, how to do that. We all like how-tos because there's things that we just want to learn. There are certain things that we want to learn. Whether they're valuable or not is really up to us, but we like how-tos. And in religious life, we get a lot of it in preaching life. As a pastor, I get a lot of, that sounds great, pastor, but how do I? How do I? And Paul now moves from his autobiographical argument about justifying his authority as an apostle and his theological defense of justification by grace through faith alone, that you are saved by faith alone. And he moves into the part, which he often does in most of his letters, of application. He's given all his theological truth, and you can just imagine him saying that all these people are reading this, and they're saying, well, how do I do that? How do I do that? And so the question we want to try and answer through our text this morning is, how do we live free? And this is probably going to take a couple of weeks. We'll cover verses 1 through 15 today, and we'll cover the next part of it next week in 15 through 26. And so let's answer this question by just walking through this text this morning. The first thing we have to do is to stand firm in the freedom that we receive through faith in Jesus. Paul says, for freedom, Christ has set us free. That's an indicative statement. If you are a follower of Jesus, if you have received Jesus as Lord and Savior, you are free. Who sets you free? Jesus. Jesus has set you free. You didn't set yourself free. Only Jesus sets you free. And because Jesus has set us free, he gives this imperative, this command, to stand firm then and don't submit again to the yoke of slavery. So we got to understand, first of all, that we are freedom and that being free starts with a relationship with Jesus. If you are not a follower of Jesus, if you would not call yourself a follower of Jesus, as we've read through Galatians, you are not free. He has told us that you are in bondage to our old nature, to the law, and all of its demands. In the presence of God, we are free from the curse of the law. In the presence of God, we live free. And to live free as God's sons and daughters, we have to be followers of Jesus. We have to believe in Jesus and not just believe in Jesus, because what Paul works through here, and as we talk about application and anything when it comes to Scripture, it's taking it from here to here to here and here. If your theology only goes here, is nothing. It is of no use to you, and it is of no use to anybody else. If you say, I believe in Jesus, but nobody in the world can see how you live that out, what point is it? Paul never implies that an intellectual faith can get you anywhere. Any faith that we receive, any instruction that we see by the power of the Spirit as we walk through this, is to be lived out every single day. And we'll talk more about that as we go through these things. Romans 8:2, Paul says, because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. We are set free from the law of sin and death only by a relationship with Jesus as our Lord and our Savior. That's it. Being free is the result of the death of Jesus. For freedom, Christ has set us free. We were captives. Paul's explained this all through the letter. But Jesus' death on the cross redeemed us from the curse of the law, paid the price in our place, purchased our redemption. As you look through the New Testament, as you see freedom, you will always inevitably see it tied to redemption. Because the only way to be free was for somebody to pay for it for you. The Bible makes this clear all through these things. In Ephesians, he talks about in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our sins. We were captives, but now we are free. John 8:36, Jesus says, "So if the Son sets you free, you really will be free." And then I know some of you are already thinking, "I don't feel free." Remember, feelings cannot dictate reality. The minute we learn that as followers of Jesus, we'll be much better off. Being free is life in the Spirit of God. For we eagerly await through the Spirit, by faith, the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision accomplishes anything. What matters is faith working through love. 2 Corinthians 3:17, Paul says this, "Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." Now, I have to ask you a question. Is the Spirit of God hovering around us? Is it just some like aura over our building? Is it some kind of metaphysical force? No. The Holy Spirit of God, for those who are followers of Jesus, is right here. If you're a follower of Jesus and the Spirit of the Lord is in here, then you're free. We have to grasp that theological concept in order to truly experience what it means and understand what it means to be free as a follower of Jesus. And I know some of you are just like, "But how?" Be patient. It's going to take this week and next week to unpack what this means. And you guys are going to look for some kind of list and things, and that's not what this is about. We have done a disservice to ourselves and our walk in our freedom because we've so prone to our checklists and our do's and our don'ts. And so what we do instead is walk around in bondage instead of living free. So that's why we're walking through this and trying to understand this even more, because it's how God wants us to live. We cannot understand freedom until we understand that our freedom is through the work of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. We've read Ephesians chapter 1 a couple of times through this series. We have been chosen by the Father, we have been redeemed by the Son, and we have been sealed by the Holy Spirit. These are truths that are evident in our life, and this was planned before the foundation of the world, according to Paul in Ephesians chapter 1. This is the truth of the reality of a follower of Jesus. The work of God, the triune God. We need to give the Spirit a little more credit than we often give him. Amen. In how he works and what he does and how he functions in the world and especially in our lives. It's amazing to me how we talk about being spiritual, but then you start talking about the Holy Spirit in church and people get all freaked out. And because of that, we tend to lean back on things that don't make us free and don't help us to live free. Freedom is something that we know about. Freedom is something we enjoy. Freedom is something we experience and that we cannot know fully until we let go of trying to live by what imprisons us. Amen. This is what the Judaizers were trying to do to the Galatians. They were trying to steal the Galatians' freedom by saying to them, follow Jesus, but be circumcised. Follow the festivals. Do all the things that the Jewish religion did and does. And Paul says that's not the gospel, because it's not the gospel. We are saved by faith through grace alone. And when we start adding things to the list, when we start putting requirements on other people, when our gospel presentation says, follow Jesus, but then now you got to do this, 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 and this, we do not understand the gospel. And the whys of why we do what we do and live the way we live. Being free is being liberated to be everything that God wants us to be and do what He wants us to do. That is freedom. It drives me crazy. You know, certain things drive me crazy, guys, and I usually get myself in trouble for having these thoughts about craziness. But you guys know a lot of times for me and on my social media posts, I'm really boring. I put a scripture and then a thought from my devotional, and that's pretty much about it. I may put a picture of my turkeys from Thursday. I do that intentionally just because I don't want to be trolled, and I don't want a whole bunch of people sitting there psychoanalyzing and the theologues jumping down what I do or say or don't say compared to their theological filter. So I just don't put myself in a place to have to deal with that. But you know, as you go to look at memes for Galatians 5:1, where it says, for freedom Christ has set us free, it drives me crazy when we start using this verse to talk about America. I see the American flag draped all over this verse all the time, and I'm like, that's wrong. What do you mean that's wrong? That's not what the verse is talking about. And I can guarantee you this, Thomas Jefferson probably was not thinking about this verse when he put certain inalienable rights given to us by our Creator in the Declaration of Independence. Now, for some of you, that's an offensive statement that we cannot put the American flag with Galatians 5:1. Sorry. Moving on. The freedom that God gives us is something for us to enjoy. The Judaizers were coming in, and they're trying to get people to follow all these rules and regulations and all these feasts and everything else that's associated with Judaism. But then as we read later, there's another side to this that's going on as well. There are those that are coming in and they're taking the other side of the view. Follow Jesus. Oh, great. Follow Jesus. Guess what? That means the law doesn't apply to me anymore. That means the Ten Commandments don't apply to my life anymore. I got the Spirit of God in me. He's forgiven me. I am sealed, and I don't have to worry about nothing. So I'm going to go out and live like a heathen for the rest of my life and say, follow Jesus. That's wrong, too. And then in church life, you get everybody mixed into that batch. See, folks, this is why things like, big words here, theology and doctrine matter. Amen. If you come to me and say, all that matters is Jesus loved me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Is that wrong? The statement is not wrong, but is that everything? No. More to it. We live in a world, and they lived in a world where the enemy of the devil himself is trying to get you to live in bondage again. Where the spirit of the age tries to keep you living in bondage again. The enemies and principalities of this world try to keep you living in bondage again and keeping these things that keep you down and keep you from living the life that God intends for you to live, desires for you to live, that Jesus came and died on the cross and rose from the dead for you to live. And to fall back into that in either direction is to fall back into bondage. Just one is really legalistic and one is bondage to your own flesh and spirits. Somebody asked me after the last service, it's like, why do we do that? We do. We as humans, we tend to fall one way or the other. And I keep telling you guys, because I believe it's true, God lives somewhere in the middle here. God is a God of order and a God of balance. We don't like order or balance. We want to swing one way or the other. It's becoming true in our religious life. It's becoming true in our personal lives. It's becoming certainly true in the political chaos of the country in which God has placed us. We all think we're living free. To be free is to be able to do those things that Pastor Tim prayed about. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do those things which God has prepared in advance for us to do. That's freedom. The freedom to worship in spirit and in truth. The freedom to share the truth and good news with people in the world. The freedom to go out and make a difference in this world. The freedom to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the freedom to love your neighbor as yourself. Not the love that you think about. Remember, Jesus gave us the love. A new command I give you, love one another. That's not the new command. The new command was the following verse. We skip over this. To love as Jesus loves us. That's freedom. Romans 6:22. But now since you have been set free from sin and have become enslaved to God, you have your fruit, which results in sanctification. Big word. All it means is becoming more like Jesus. We are to become more like Jesus. We have the freedom in Christ by the Spirit to become more like Jesus. And the outcome is eternal life. That's the end of sanctification. We sang an old hymn in the last service. We sing a lot of old hymns in the last service because for most people in here, that's an old hymn. But when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. That's the goal of faith. We've reduced, because of our afraid of using words like theology and doctrine and not understanding, we throw all these other things in. The end goal of living life for Jesus is to glorify him, advance his kingdom, love him, love your neighbor, and to get to heaven. Too many Christians today live with a constant reality and constant reading and constant exposure of trying to find the new you. When the new you existed the day you accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. And we got to be careful not to throw that stuff in there. The gospel is simple. The gospel is pure. And the minute we start adding all this other stuff to it, we start ceasing to make it the gospel. Well, I don't know what the gospel is. Sure you do. How do you say you don't know what the gospel is when you sit there and tell me you're a follower of Jesus? Right? Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, came to earth, lived a perfect, sinless life, and he died on the cross for our sins. Why did he do that? Out of love. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Next verse. For God did not come into the world to judge the world, but that the world through him might be saved. You keep going on and reading with that. He talks about, I don't need to condemn the world. We're condemned already. I love this. When people just do this to you. They get this. They do this to you to shut you down. They do it by saying that don't judge. Don't condemn me. Brothers and sisters, I'm not condemning you. If you don't know Jesus, you're already condemned. I'm sorry. That's what Scripture clearly says. I don't have to do that. It's not my job to do that. It's the gospel's job and the power of the Holy Spirit to bring conviction. You have to acknowledge that you're a sinner, that you're in bondage to it. Well, yeah, I can do that. Okay, yeah, I can. Yeah, I ain't perfect. We all like I ain't perfect, but don't call me a sinner. I'm like, how does that work? See, our God in heaven is perfectly holy and perfect in every single way. But he loved us, and so he sent Jesus to die for us in our place. They buried him in the tomb. 3 days later, the stone was rolled away, and he walked out. God demonstrates his love for us, and then while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. See, Romans 5:8. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 6:23. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. That's Romans 10, 9, and 10. That's what a 91-year-old man and a 70-year-old man did in the last service. Now, I know the teenager in y'all is going like, well, man, they must be really stupid. Oh, they may be stupid, but they're going to heaven. Live free. And this is the point. See, Paul never gives you theology without giving you a reason why it's important to live it out. And these are the social implications of what we have as followers of Jesus. He talks about this. Being free has social implications. Freedom is the freedom to love others. No, yeah. See, when we get to the fruit of the Spirit next week, it's the freedom to love and have joy and have peace. That's freedom. You have freedom to love and have joy and have peace and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. You are free to live that way, to be that way. Why? Because the Spirit of God is in you, guiding you and empowering you to do these things. Yeah, but, no, but, stop it. Just live it. To love others. Freedom to love others without distinction. Now, when we went to Galatians 3, I talked about how this verse, we use it a lot, and we can because there's truth in it, but it's in context of sharing the gospel. When we share the gospel with people, and the gospel goes to Jews and Greeks and slaves and free, male and female, since you are all one in Christ Jesus. There's no distinction. Do I got to love him? Yup. Do you got to love her? Yup. I can't. You're right. But God can. And God does. Well, how does he do that? Through you. Well, I don't want him to do it through me. Okay, great. So, God says love. You say, I'm not going to love because I don't want to. So, God says, you say not. What have you just done? You sinned. Because you have this false sense of what it means to be free. You are free to sin or not. It's that simple. I get it. A lot of people in this world that we don't want to have a high opinion of. A lot of people have treated us badly. A lot of people treat us like dirt. A lot of people who we have these social things that have been ingrained into our head about what they are and how they live and what they think and all of these things. And we live in a world where the enemy keeps constantly berating us and trying to get us to do what we just talked about a minute ago, trying to get us to think as if it's us versus them. It's white people versus black people. It's black people versus Hispanics. It's Hispanics versus Asians. It's Asians versus that. They just make it. They constantly do that to us. They keep throwing it in our face over and over again. And a sad part is many of us as Christians keep falling for this nonsense. When Paul clearly says there is no distinction. It drives me crazy that this world keeps wanting me to sit there and say, look at Jeanette one way, look at Ron another way, look at Giselle another way, look at he another way, when they're my brother and sister in Christ. Amen. And the world keeps throwing it in our face. Their agenda keeps throwing it in my face. But we are free for it to just be he and just be Jeanette and just be Bron and just be Giselle. We can't fall for that nonsense. Because there's no distinction between Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. Well, Pastor, you're just trying to disrespect my heritage. No, I'm not. I get this crazy stuff. I'm not trying to disrespect you. Are you kidding me? I'm just trying to look at you the way God says I'm supposed to look at you. I'm not trying to negate anything else. Just trying to be what Jesus has set me free to be. I deal with this all the time in church life, in the community. Good grief, in our denomination, it drives me insane. Understanding what it means for the follower of Jesus to be free helps us to stand against those teaching something else contrary to the gospel message. And this is what drives me the most insane. See, what's happening in the Galatian church, he's talked a lot about the Judaizers and all the things that they're bringing out, but now we got these other group of people in there, they're on the other end that we just talked about. It's called libertinism. This is the view that kind of says, it's about me. My Christianity's about me. And this is where this language that we use, that's not necessarily wrong, but we got to be careful when we use it, a personal relationship with Jesus, we take personal to mean it's just about me and God and doesn't matter about anything else, and you find nothing like that in the New Testament. Our faith is to be lived out in the world, in community, with one another, period. You cannot find anything else. Lone Ranger Christianity, for those of you old enough, the Marlboro Man Christian, that is garbage. It's not biblical, and it's created all kinds of problems. You ever talk to the guy who says, man, I can worship God with a six-pack and a fishing pole? I had that conversation years ago. Chris and I were on one of them Jeep rides in Sedona. First of all, witnessing to people in Sedona is always an interesting experience. They look at the world in a little different lens as they beam from portal to portal to portal. If you don't know what that is, go to Sedona. But that's what he said. Nice guy, good guy. I worship God by having a six-pack and a fishing pole. No, you don't. And no, you don't. And no, I don't if I thought that way. That's not what we've been free to do. And so this is why theology and understanding how we relate, how God relates to us and how we relate to other people is really, really important, and to teach that within the confines of the church. Because I don't know if you've ever been in a room where there's a bunch of legalists and a bunch of libertines in the same room. We probably have it in that room right now. I'm telling you, we probably have that in this very room. In this very room. Right now. You didn't know it was called that, but we do. What it was causing in the Galatian church was chaos. What it causes in the church in 2022 is chaos and confusion. And both of them ultimately lead people to living again in bondage. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. We have to understand the ramifications of not living free. He gives this here. I mean, he's pretty passionate about it. It was interesting to read through all these things. Not living free means Jesus coming was useless. You are trying to be justified by the law. You are alienated from Christ. You have fallen from grace. That's pretty harsh language. To sit there and live by the commands of the law, whatever commands you feel like are those. Because just by that person saying, you know, a six-pack and a fishing pole, that's their own law. They're judged by the law of God, but that's their own law they've created for themselves, and they're in bondage to it. The next thing is not living free means you are obligated to the whole law and to its whole system. Remember, God is holy. And so if you're going to follow it, basically what he's saying is if you're going to get circumcised, then you're back to following all of it again. All of it. All 600 laws for the Sabbath and all of it. You don't get to pick and choose. That's libertinism. That's freedom for you. That's that individualism that is wrong. And you're not living free means we opt out of the system of grace. You're choosing to live on your own. You're choosing to do it by your own standard. Oh yeah, God, I know what you said, but I got my own standard. I mean, really? I mean, do we ever really think about how we talk to God about stuff like this? God, I know what you said. That sounds cool, but I got my own. I'm not quite sure how my own system is better than grace. Unless I'm God. And that's ultimately where both of them end up. Fundamentalism and libertinism end up to you being your own God, even though you're saying you're worshiping the true God. We have to think about these things. Somebody comes to know Jesus, and they come to be a follower of Jesus. What do we do? Great, you come to know Jesus. Now we give them now you got to do this, now you got to do this, now you gotta. We got to quit saying gotta. What do you mean you got to quit saying gotta? Gotta is bondage. Want to is freedom. As the old expression says, you change your want to because you want to. People come to you and they say, how does this work? I mean, I'm reading my Bible and I ain't getting nothing. As if reading their Bible, they're supposed to get some kind of whatever they think. Like their problems are all going to go away. As if the person they're trying to match themselves up against doesn't have their own problems, you just don't know about them. I don't understand why this is happening. I read my Bible, I pray, I go to church. You're setting yourself up as God. God, if I'm doing this, you're supposed to work for me at this point. Where do you find that? His promises are his promises, but your commands to the Almighty Creator of the universe? Choose grace. It's free. That's what it means. Not living free means you miss out on faith. You miss out on faith. Galatians chapter 6, verse 15, Paul kind of alludes to it here. He's, for both circumcision and uncircumcision mean nothing. What matters instead is a new creation. See, that's what matters. The new creation. You are a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all things are new. Put on the new self. Put off the old self. There's the new you. The new you that's free to love God, love your neighbor, glorify Him, advance His kingdom. That's where it is. There's an important thing we got to remember here, and he kind of alludes to this, and I'm going to wrap up here in the time we have left here. Keep running free. You got to keep running free. Paul talks about, man, if I'm preaching circumcision, then why am I being persecuted? The cross doesn't mean anything if he's preaching circumcision. You know what's interesting as you read through these things, just a little sidebar freebie, I'm not going to get into too much detail. There was a many, and you can see this actually in the apocryphal literature of 1 Maccabees. There were many who wanted to reject their Jewishness, but they were circumcised, you know, 7 days after they were born. There was actually, it was practiced for about 500 years, maybe still practiced today, I don't know. People who wanted to get, who were circumcised, who had a medical procedure done without anesthetic to get uncircumcised. That's all I'm going to say about that. Because people just don't understand. It comes from a misunderstanding. We're not running the race well. We're not running free. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24, Paul says, "Don't you know that runners in a stadium all race, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way to win the prize." How you running? That's your statement right there. It just tells you that the truly libertine freedom to do whatever you want view is not a biblical view, because you're running for a reason. "Now, everyone who competes exercises self-control in everything. They do it to receive a perishable crown, but we an imperishable crown." Self-control, that's a gift of the Holy Spirit. You are free to have self-control. Say amen. I was watching the Notre Dame USC game last night, and they were talking about the quarterback for USC, and you know, he's playing really well, and everybody's talking about the Heisman and all that stuff. And they mentioned in there that he has been on a diet plan and a training plan for what he's doing since he was 4 years old. He lives a very structured life. He gets up at 5 a.m. He's got his feeding plan. He's got his things to get done here to make sure he gets them done. And he is just, since he was 4 years old, for what? To be able to throw a football. And to go to the NFL and get paid. I get it. Paul says, man, athletes, they're willing to do all this stuff and to be self-controlled, to do the things that they do in order to be their best. He says, and they're doing that for a perishable crown. We're doing it for an imperishable crown. "So I do not run like one who runs aimlessly, or box like one beating in the air." Who have you ever beat by boxing the air? Nobody. And because we don't understand the freedom we have in Christ, and what Paul is writing and explaining all this to us, we have too many followers of Jesus who are just wandering aimlessly through life without meaning and purpose, because they haven't understood that they have been set free to live this life for the glory of God. And we should go for it. "Instead, I discipline my body and bring it under strict control, so that after preaching to others, I myself will not be disqualified." And all of y'all are saying, "Well, that just applies to you, preacher." Oh, no, it doesn't. Hebrews 12, verse 1. The writer says, therefore, since we have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The picture there is one of just the Olympics, and for the marathon runners coming in. For the last part of the marathon, they tend to come into the stadium and they run a couple laps around, and everybody's cheering them on to finish the race. And at the end of the tape, there's a line that they run through for first, second, third, and all to finish to say that they've won the race. And the picture here is of those cloud of witnesses. Because remember, Hebrews 11 is the chapter about all the heroes of the faith in chapter 11 we looked at earlier this year. So it's people like Abraham and Noah and Gideon and Moses. Those are the ones that are up in the stands. Billy Graham, D.L. Moody, maybe Grandma and Grandpa. They're cheering you on to keep running free. Lay aside all the stuff, the legalisms that keep you bound up and repressed and do all these things in the name of holiness. Don't get caught up over here in all this libertarianism and doing whatever you want, because then you just get bound up in the bondage of your flesh, which Jesus saved you to free you from those things. Live in the power and grace of the Holy Spirit right there in the middle. Live unhindered. Live free. Why? Because Jesus is at the tape. Any of you ever done Special Olympics? You ever worked Special Olympics? Years ago, I was a hugger for Special Olympics. All I did all day was hug people. But these aren't just your regulation hugs. And you hugged everybody. When those runners, because I was on the track field, and when those runners ran their 100-yard sprint, those that ran in the Special Olympics, they're just running at you. You had a lane, you were assigned a lane, and you were cheering that person on, cheering that person on, cheering that person on. They didn't know you from Adam. They just knew that you were at the end of the tape, and they were running after you. And when they finished that race, they crossed the tape. My job was to give them a hug and say, great job. You did great. You did awesome. It didn't matter whether they finished last or first. That's Hebrews chapter 12. That's running the race. That's living free. So let me wrap up here real quickly. Galatians 5, verse 13 through 15 says, for you were called to be free. Who called you to be free? Not me. Jesus did. Jesus did. You were called to be free, brothers and sisters. Only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. What are the works of the flesh? We'll get to that next week. You probably know them already. But to serve one another through love. Watch out, or you will be consumed by one another as yourself. That's the inevitable consequence when love isn't the first priority, when the Spirit is not empowering. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out, or you will be consumed by one another. How do we not do that? Come back next week, I'll tell you. Or just read the rest of the chapter. We live free when we put our faith and hope in Jesus. Period. Period. We live free by the power of the Holy Spirit in us, period. We live free when we know and understand the difference between freedom and bondage. And that, my friends, is what we would call in church life doctrine and theology. That's why we have small groups and do all those things that we do to help with that. We demonstrate our freedom when we love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, when we love our neighbors as ourselves, and when we love our church. Amen. Because that is where all of this gets played out.
Amen.
How many of you were here last Sunday night? If you weren't here last Sunday night, I feel so bad for you. If you're new to us, the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we usually do a whole church Thanksgiving meal, and it was awesome, and there was a lot of turkey. It was like 8 turkey breasts and 4 spiral cut hams, and y'all ate every single last bit of it. So we ate together. And we worship together. We worship together in English and in Spanish. Why? Because that's who we are.
Amen.
That's how we're supposed to be.
Amen.
It's beautiful. Is it perfect? No, but because we're part of it. That's what we're free to do. That's what you're free to do. Love our church. Love your neighbor. Love God.
Amen.
Head to the heart, to the hands, to the feet, for his glory and his kingdom. In Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time in your word. We thank you for grace and freedom. We are free to live as you've called us to live. Lord, if anybody is in this room who's never committed their life to Jesus, they can, from where they're at, acknowledge what you are already doing in their lives. I'm just a spokesperson. The power of the Spirit is the one who changes lives, not me. They can say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins. I believe he rose from the dead 3 days later. And God, today I make him Lord and Savior of my life. And God, I don't even pretend to understand what all that means. But that's why there's a church. Lord, I'm tired of living in bondage. Help me to live free. Empower me to live free. For your glory and your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's all stand.
Joy to the world. Joy to the world. The Lord is better. Right.
goodness.